The first spotlight session for the evening is the human factor. Cybersecurity is made out of people. And the spotlight speaker will be Mr. Misha Glenny, renowned and award-winning investigative journalist, leading expert on cybercrime. But before I start on with this session, please help me welcome Mr. K.P. Unnikrishnan, Vice President, Marketing, Asia Pacific and Japan, Palo Alto Networks, as he would be hosting an interactive session and introducing Mr. Misha Glenny. Before I welcome Mr. K.P. Unnikrishnan on stage, let me take this opportunity to introduce him to all of you. Mr. K.P. Unnikrishnan is a part of the Palo Alto Networks regional management team that is responsible for the company's growth strategy in the Asia Pacific and Japan region. He runs strategic initiatives across the region to help industry, academia, and government organizations be more cyber savvy and improve their cyber prowess to have a breach prevention based infrastructure. Mr. Unnikrishnan has worked in the technology sector for more than 24 years, including management roles in marketing, strategy, partnership, and sales. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together to welcome Mr. K.P. Unnikrishnan on the stage.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me immense pleasure to not only host, but also to introduce somebody who a lot of people in my industry look up at. Before I give more introduction, it'll be hilarious for me to just say, I was telling my chief security officer that I'm going to be meeting Misha Glenny, and he was very excited. I told my mom that Tabu is going to be there after me. She got excited. Very clearly two different stakeholders in a forum like this. But let me start off by introducing Misha. He's an award-winning journalist who's made a name for himself in BBC Central Europe correspondent covering the 1989 revolution and the wars of former Yugoslavia. He has a Sony Gold Award for outstanding contribution to broadcasting, and he's also a winner of BT's Information Security Journalist of the Year. He's regularly consulted by governments and law enforcement agencies in Europe, the Americas, on the Balkans, East European, transnational organized cyber crime and crime security. His books, which is very well known, McMafia, Seriously Organized Crime and Dark Market, How Hackers Become the New Mafia, was shortlisted for several prizes. And McMafia has been adapted in a joint production between AMC in the US and BBC into a major television series. His most recent book, Nemesis, A Man and the Battle for Rio, is a biography of the former head of a major Brazilian cocaine cartel, who Misha interviewed at length in prison. Nemesis is also a production as a Hollywood feature film that's going to come out pretty soon. Misha can speak on all aspects of organized crime for money laundering, cyber malfeasance, people smuggling, and the drug trade. His unique insights into how technology is reshaping traditional crime in narcotics, smuggling, and sex trade. Misha recently served as the visiting professor for Columbia University's Harriman Institute, where he ran a course on entitled Crime, Corruption, and Economic Transition. He was voted the best lecturer in CEPA for his work over there. Misha has also worked as professor in the London School of Economics and is currently preparing a master's course for University College London. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for the one and only Misha Glenny.
Hey. Thank you. Hello and welcome. This is always the most challenging moment of a talk to see if the technology is working, but I see it is. First of all, I would like to thank ABP, and I would like to thank the government of West Bengal most sincerely for inviting me to Calcutta. Because usually when I give these sorts of talks, I'm flying to Barcelona from London or Frankfurt or Vienna. These are places that I know well, so I fly in and then I fly out as soon as I've finished the speech. But as I was coming to Calcutta, I thought, well, I've got to take a bit of time. So I've spent the last couple of days walking around this fascinating city and soaking in all its history. Now, of course, if you're a British person coming to Calcutta, that historical connection is very strong. I can't help but feeling a little bit of humility when I come here as a British person, because although the British founded Calcutta, they also sucked most of the resources and riches out of Bengal through this city, so you can feel a bit guilty. But I think it's very important to learn about history. I always think history's extremely important, and particularly these days when we're in the middle of what Infocom 2019 rightly calls VUCA, which is volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, because we really are living in very strange times indeed. I don't know if any of you have visited Britain recently, but Brexit is a form of collective suicide, the like of which I didn't even see in somewhere like Yugoslavia. It's really quite extraordinary what's happening. And then over the Atlantic, we have Trump and all his strange ways, and Trump is involved in a global trade war with China, where Xi Jinping is becoming more authoritarian by the day, and he's getting closer to Vladimir Putin in the Kremlin, and all sorts of weird things are happening. And then we have elsewhere, we have Delhi, for example, Delhi constantly under fog and pollution. We've got Australia on fire. The Amazon is on fire. I know Brazil very well, and believe you me, when the Amazon is on fire, we all have to get very worried indeed. And then we now have the issues around cyber. We have the social credit system in China, which is truly like something out of George Orwell, where people's behavior is monitored through internet technologies. And then we have something called surveillance capitalism in the United States. That's Google, and that's Facebook, and they're gathering all our data, and they're selling it, and they're predicting how we're going to behave. I have found a way of defeating the algorithms of surveillance capitalism, because I am an author. And I don't know if you know, but one things that authors do, their favorite recreational activity is checking to see where their books are on the Amazon bestseller list. So you spend days and days looking up Amazon saying, oh, I've gone from 41,000 to 40,000. I must be a bestseller. That means somebody almost bought one copy of your book, by the way. But anyway, because of that, the only advertisements I get from when I'm browsing the internet are advertisements for my own books. So I have completely defeated the algorithms of surveillance capitalism. Here in Calcutta, I notice when it comes to cybercrime, you have an epidemic of skimming, the skimming of debit and credit cards, cloning those cards. Now, in my wanderings, I've looked at one or two of your ATM machines here, and I've got to tell you, they are purpose-built for skimmers. They are very, very easy to skim. And I'm afraid you've got to up your game on that one, both the banks and the ATM manufacturers and the systems manufacturers. And of course, we're just down the road from Dhaka and Bangladesh. Of course, the Bangladesh Central Bank, you know about that. The biggest, biggest cybercrime in history so far. But there's more coming, because the critical national infrastructures of all of our countries are under attack. So in these times of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, I thought, well, let's go back to a bit of history, and let's go back to a time which was a little more joyful, a little more optimistic than the times of VUCA. And so, what I want to do is to go to, let's have a look, 1989. Yes, the end of the Cold War in 1989. It was a moment of great optimism. It was the first major story that I covered as a journalist. The end of the Cold War after 40 years, when ordinary people who were fed up with being told how to live their lives from cradle to grave, they rose up and they demanded the restoration of their civil and democratic rights. It was a moment that was pregnant with great optimism, where ideas like liberal democracies, the common European home, and even aspirations to world peace appeared to reign supreme. Freedom! Revolution! Some people even called it the end of history. Can you imagine that? The end of history. That's what we were promised. That's what the American thinker Francis Fukuyama told us was coming, and many of us believed us. Well, I'm afraid it wasn't the end of history, but it was the end of a historical epoch, and one that had begun exactly 200 years earlier in 1789 with the French Revolution. But there is no end to history, my friends, and the birth of a new epoch is always difficult, dangerous, and very bloody. So, what was going on here? Well, it wasn't just the ideology of communism which collapsed in 1989. For several years, the state suffered a heart attack as well. And while it was on life support, another big change was happening. The planned economy of the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe was being replaced by the capitalist free market economy of the victorious West. So picture this, if you will. Two Russian entrepreneurs at the dawn of capitalism. How do they go about making a deal?
Господин Иванов, I am businessman from Moscow. I wish to sell you widgets for 3 rubles apiece.
Здравствуйте, господин Климов. I like your widgets, but please, I pay only 2 rubles and 50 kopecks.
Господин Иванов, I am cheating myself at 2 rubles 50. Perhaps we can go to commercial tribunal to settle our dispute there.
I would like, but there is no court system in Russia that functions. However, I have friends. They belong to so-called privatized law enforcement agency. Perhaps they will help you strike a good deal with me.
Ужас, но я тоже. Perhaps my privatized law enforcement agency can strike an even fairer deal with yours.
Now, what sociologists call the privatized law enforcement agency, we know better as the mob or the mafia. Say what you will about the mafia, they were indispensable for the emergence of a free market system in Eastern Europe. I was very privileged to be invited to the inaugural annual general meeting of Bulgaria's nascent capitalist class, and I treasure the photographic memento I have of that event. There we are. I don't know if you, many of you here know Bulgaria. It's not a big country. It's about 9 million people, so not many people know about it. But before 1989, I don't know if you remember, every 4 years at the Olympic Games, the Bulgarians would win lots and lots of medals in things like weightlifting and wrestling. These were the superstars of communist Bulgaria. So what was going to happen when their money ran out, their subsidies, because they were subsidized by the communist government? But in 1989, the Bulgarian government, like all governments in Eastern Europe, were flat broke, and so they could no longer afford to pay for people like these. And so these guys, and lots of their friends, a lot of police officers who were sacked, they all came together and they found gainful employment as privatized law enforcement agents, or the mafia. And they worked together with a group called the oligarchs, like our friends from the animation, Ivanov and Klimov. So the oligarchs were people who, before 1989, they were opportunistic people who made the clunky system of the planned economy in the Soviet Union in Eastern Europe, they made it work. But when the revolution happened in 1989 and 1990, they saw their opportunity because they were great entrepreneurs. And so when all of the state assets were being privatized, they leapt on them like raptors. You see, if you were an oligarch, you could buy a barrel of oil in Siberia for $1. You could take it over to Lithuania in the Baltic states, already independent, and sell it for $30 a barrel. I mean, these are huge profits, vast profits, the sort of profits that otherwise you only get from cocaine or from the popcorn you buy at cinemas. Or indeed onions in Calcutta. Quite extraordinary. So huge profits. And with all that money slashing around, then of course what you need is you need somebody to protect you. Privatized law enforcement agencies or the mafia. Now, the mafia were clever people. They're not stupid. They looked at all these oligarchs making money who they were protecting. And they said, well, maybe we could actually enter the market as well and not just regulate the market. And so they did. And sometimes they would buy and sell food or furniture, but sometimes they would shift drugs or they would traffic women. Because remember, the state is still on life support. So who is to define what is a legal commodity and an illegal commodity? And this system had a name. It was called gangster capitalism. And it's very important to remember at this time that capitalism in Eastern Europe and Russia was intertwined with political corruption and organized crime from the very beginning. Now, I'm going to get on to cyber in a minute, but there's something which both cyber and traditional organized crime do together, and they do it very well. Because when you're making all this money, you've got to find something to do with it. And this is where people in Eastern Europe realized that the West offered answers to them. Because what had happened in the West in the 1970s, the 80s, and the 90s was the deregulation of the financial system and the emergence of something called financial capitalism. And huge sums of money were swishing around the world. And the East European oligarchs and organized crime groups saw this system where the West was not really regulating anything, and they said, this is our philosopher's stone. This is the way that we can take dirty money and turn it into pristine gold, the Western banking system and the tax havens. Now, when it came to writing my book about traditional organized crime, McMafia, I was able to describe this. But when it came turning that into a television show, that was really challenging because, believe me, as somebody who studied the subject, money laundering is a witlessly boring subject. It's very, very tedious. But I think the writer, Hossamini, and the director, James Watkins, when they came to describe money laundering in McMafia, they did a great job. So I want to show you a clip of this, and I'm partly showing you a clip because there's one person in this clip who you should recognize. The story so far is that our Anglo-Russian anti-hero, Alex Godman, is about to make his first dodgy payment from his hedge fund in London to an organized criminal syndicate 3,500 miles away in Mumbai. So this is all happening in the 1990s, and then in the year 2000, something new pitches up. And this is very important what happens then. This is the year 2000. It's the year when the first virus goes around the world in less than 48 hours, and it's called the I Love You virus. Now, I don't know if you remember the I Love You virus. Some of you are probably too young to remember it. Some of you may not have been affected by it. But it went around the world over a weekend, as I say. And so just to remind you what was going on, I'll explain to you what was happening, because this happened to me. I was there. So there I was, working away, you're working away. It's a weekend, so you're already pretty irritated because you're working at the weekend. You're bored. And suddenly you get an email in your inbox, and it says, I love you. And it comes from somebody you know. That's exciting. And it's somebody who you happen to have fancied for years but were never able to say it. Oh, you're so excited. And so you look at that email and you click on the link and you're doomed because you spread the virus further and your own computer is infected. It's absolutely terrible. Now, I was very fortunate when the I Love You virus first came out. I was very fortunate indeed. Because the first person I received it from was my ex-wife. And she harbored all sorts of emotions towards me, but I can assure you, here and now, love was not amongst them. So as soon as I saw that in my inbox, I said, aye, aye, something very strange going on here, and it went straight into the recycle bin, and I spared myself a very nasty infection. Now, the reason why I tell this story is because the I Love You virus is at the heart of most of the problems we have in cybersecurity. Because when cybercriminals saw the success of the I Love You virus, they realized that with computers, they could now leverage human fragility, human vulnerability, and dare I say it, human stupidity on an unprecedented level. We all have to learn how to read our computers, because most people fall into the trap of believing that they have an intimate relationship with their computers. It's just me and the computer, and no one else is watching. Nothing could be further from the truth. And this is why the human factor is so important. To this day, 85% roughly of all data breaches take place as a consequence of a successful phishing attack. And that's why we all have to learn more. We all need to be educated about cybersecurity, and we also need to spread that in companies, in government institutions, and at our home as well. Now, I want to explain a little bit about how this arose. In the same year, the year 2000, we saw the emergence of the website that revolutionized cybercrime on the internet. So let me introduce you to the wonderful world of CarterPlanet.com. Now, this was an advertisement from 20 years ago, and it was incredibly successful. It drew thousands and thousands of visitors to CarterPlanet.com, which was a sort of Facebook for criminals. So you could learn the latest techniques for perpetrating cybercrime. You could download viruses against payment to use against your potential enemies. And in addition to that, you could buy and sell fake IDs and documents And above all else, you could buy and sell the data of cloned credit and debit cards. So this is what you would see when you went on to GardaPlanet.com. It was important that it was very professional, but also the key thing about GardaPlanet was that they came up with a solution to the biggest problem facing criminals on the internet. And that is, how can I do business with this guy when I know he's a criminal, so it's axiomatic that he's untrustworthy? How do I get around that? And so the administrators of GardaPlanet came up with the escrow system for criminals. So let's say you were a criminal with 5,000 credit or debit card that you wanted to sell. You would send that digitally to the escrow officer at GardaPlanet. Meanwhile, the potential purchaser would send digital money to the escrow officer. He would then take some of the credit card data and send it to his friends in Rio, Toronto, Wellington. They would try it out on local ATM systems. And if it worked, which it usually did, then this would be used as a fee for the escrow service before the purchaser got the data and the vendor got the money. This led to an explosion of cybercrime and credit card fraud in the first decade of this century, which is known as the champagne era for carders and for people engaged in fraud of one kind or another. So that was what's happening in the first decade of this century. And then everything starts to explode because the cyber criminals become more and more clever about how they can exploit human vulnerability and fragility. Have a look at this little clip here.
So I came into the office one day and someone said, "Hey, we're working on that wire transfer you requested." And I gave him a funny look. I'm like, "What are you talking about? I didn't request a wire transfer."
He says it was an email chain, supposedly from him to the CFO, then forwarded to accounting, asking for more than $357,000 to be transferred immediately.
It just looked like a normal business communication. Then we stared at the email, and then we noticed that the I and the F were flipped around.
Now, not many people, unless you're in the industry, know about this particular crime, which is called CEO fraud. But it is one of the most lucrative cyber crimes out there at the moment. The FBI, of course, are fairly hot on it, and they've identified just how much money, $12 billion, that's over a five-year period. But what is most striking about CEO fraud, which is fooling senior managers into signing off cash and sending it to another account, what is most striking about it is the individual sums that are involved sometimes. The records so far are from two European companies, one Austrian FACC, which provides components to the aeronautics industry, and the other, Leoni, is a very famous electronics electronics company in Germany. They each lost 40 million euros apiece, and of course it has huge consequences. And this is just through carelessness. This is because you're not reading your computer correctly. I go around and I talk to boards a lot of the time, and I talk to people in companies explaining to them how they should be bringing everyone into their digital hygiene regime. But you would be amazed. I mean, it's 20 years on, we hear about breaches all the time, but you would be amazed how many companies still run their IT and their information security departments like this. Oh, don't know how that happened. Excuse me while I fix it. That just goes to show you how incredibly capricious and stupid things can be. I haven't got my glasses on either, which makes it difficult, but don't worry, we'll get there. Do beg your pardon. Just put my glasses on, and then we'll be there. We might have a problem with the mirroring here. Yeah, there we are. I beg your pardon. We'll start that again. Whoop. Here we go. So, they're as incapable as I am, it would appear.
Hello, IT? Have you tried turning it off and on again? Oh, okay, well, the button on the side, is it glowing? Yeah, you need to turn it on. The button turns it on? Yeah. You do know how a button works, don't you? No, not on clothes.
Hello, IT. Yeah, huh? Have you tried forcing an unexpected reboot?
No, there you go. No, there you go. I just heard it come on. No, that's the music you hear when it comes on. No, that's the music you hear when... I'm sorry, are you from the past?
You see, the driver hooks a function by patching the system call table, so it's not safe to unload it unless another thread's about to jump in there and do its stuff, and you don't want to end up in the middle of invalid memory. Hello?
The inimitable Roy and Moss from the IT crowd, and you can watch that all on YouTube. I highly recommend it. It is extremely funny. And so, as you see, I'm as incompetent as they are. The reason why I show that clip is because it highlights the attitudes which are still prevalent in some IT and information security departments, the patronizing attitude of Roy, and the techno-babble of Moss. But I argue that although information security and IT have a problem with communications, that the problem is equally on the side of the boards, on the side of CEOs, and on the side of other departments which need to be involved in cybersecurity. So this is from about 14 months ago, but it's very instructive from the information security officers of Fortune 500 companies. So, is your CEO regularly briefed on cybersecurity, defense strategies, and related business risks? 64% say yes. What that means for the 36% of those companies, heaven only knows. But look at this. Do you think your CEO makes decisions with cybersecurity in mind? Only 47% say yes, even though 64% have been briefing them. In your opinion, does your CEO know enough about cybersecurity? Only 39% say yes. And these figures are consistent with the sort of surveys that we get today as well. It only creeps up very slowly, this consciousness. And when asked what it is that the CEO lacks when it comes to understanding cybersecurity, always on top, it is too technical. And what we have a problem with here in many, many companies and corporations is that you have the issue of silos. Silos are a big, big problem. So you have the silo for communications, for information security, for risk management, and for finance. They all need to be talking to each other the whole time about what is going on. But they tend not to. And when it comes to the board level, well, I'm not going to mention the organization it was, but it was a huge company in the United Kingdom. I did a briefing to the board and explained to them the ABC of creating an atmosphere of digital hygiene in the whole company. They assured me that everything that I suggested to them had already been put in place. And just 3 weeks ago, they had an absolutely massive breach, which was the consequence of a very basic error at board level. So bringing together these departments is really important. And it's not just important to protect yourself, it's really important when the breach happens. Because we have seen this time and time again, that the communications department is not briefed properly about who should be talking to the media when it happens, what they should be saying, and what the message is that you want to get out. So there we have this issue of human frailty in the cybersecurity regime all the time. But strangely, things are changing. And the reason why they're changing is because of digital transformation. Digital transformation is a quite extraordinary process that is going on around the world. And the amount of money that is being funneled into this to outsourcing your digital requirements to third parties is quite astonishing. One of the interesting aspects of this is that at last boards are being peopled more and more by people with technical experience. And this is very, very important when it comes to meeting the challenges ahead, because your attack vectors are increasing all of the time. And one of the most worrying aspects of this is the fact that it's not just that you're sharing your data with third parties, but those third parties are then sharing your data with other third parties, and so on and so forth on in the supply chain. This was a big case from a couple of years ago where supermarkets in the United Kingdom, Canada, and the United States were all outsourcing their digital camera work to PNI Media. Now, when you walked into Tesco, as I might have done, and you got your digital photographs published, what you didn't know is that it wasn't Tesco that was doing it, it was PNI Media. And then PNI Media was successfully breached, hacked, and all of these companies had to explain to their customers why their data had been compromised. And of course, things like photographs are very sensitive.
The time
material.
Has come for the Internet of
and
Things.
Now,
it
IoT.
Will connect more devices and impact our lives more than anything ever before. By 2020, dozens of billions of devices will be connected to the World Wide Web, many times more than today. Exchanging information with each other, they will increase the safety, security, and convenience of everything we do.
Just run that by me one more time, if you would.
They will increase the safety, security.
It's not fun to have your two-ton SUV's brakes hacked just as you're parking in front of a ditch.
Okay, hold on tight. Hold on. Oh,
that's what I've learned from Charlie Miller and Chris Balasek, a pair of hackers who have spent the last year developing a piece of software that can wirelessly sabotage this 2014 Jeep Cherokee.
It hasn't been altered in any way. There are no devices attached to it. But like many thousands of Jeeps around the world, it can be remotely hacked over the internet through a cellular connection to its entertainment system that would allow someone to take over its steering, its transmission, and even its brakes.
So this is a big problem because we're at the moment of seeing things flipped on their head. Up until now, the great vulnerability has been the human being, the user. We are the vulnerability. Interestingly, as machine-to-machine learning and artificial intelligence have an ever greater say in our networked computer systems, and in addition to that, our dependency on networked computer systems increases exponentially by the day, it is paradoxically the absence of good human oversight that is going to be the problem. Machines are going to be our problem from now on. And we have a dearth of people who have the requisite cybersecurity qualifications to manage this extraordinary transformation.
there are other certain little problems which are slightly surreal that you will come across in the world of digital transformation. And I want to tell you about one, and that is Mondelez. This is one of the giants of global commerce. It has annual revenues of $25 billion. And a couple of years ago, it was breached. It was breached by the NotPetya ransomware. It had to get rid of 1,700 servers. 24,000 laptops were useless. They couldn't be used again. But Mondelez was a sensible company. It said, right, we're going to claim our money, $100 million, from Zurich, who were our insurance company. And Zurich came back and said, no, we're not paying out. And Mondelez have gone to court, and they've taken Zurich to court. Now, Zurich argue, because it's an insurance company, obviously they have a small print in it, they say, look at this, loss or damage directly or indirectly caused by or resulting from a hostile or warlike action by any government or sovereign power or agent or authority thereof. That's why they argued, because NotPetya was deemed by the Five Eyes, that's the intelligence services of Australia, the United States, Britain, Canada, and New Zealand, deemed to be, although they were criminals, an agent of the Russian government. Now, attribution is an imprecise science, as we know, and it's not 100% that they were an agent of the Russian government, but as far as Zurich was concerned, it's a way of not paying out the $100 million. But we have a growing crisis when it comes to cybersecurity, when it comes to the secondary market of cyber insurance, because there are a lot of get-out clauses like that. And the reason that exists is because if we pull back a moment and look at the geopolitics of cybercrime, what we find is it's very difficult increasingly to differentiate between states and criminal organizations. Let me explain to you what I mean. It would be very simple if we had the world of cybercrime, the world of cyber industrial espionage, and the world of cyber warfare as separate operations, policed respectively by the cops, by the private sector, and by the military. But because of the existence of two human agents, spies and hackers, that doesn't work. When I was researching my book, Dark Market, Dark Market was a successor site to Carter Planet, a criminal website. I discovered there very quickly that there were undercover agents of MIT, Turkish Domestic Intelligence, of the SBU, Ukrainian Intelligence, the KGB, Britain's Serious Organized Crime Agency, and MI6, the FBI, and the Secret Service from the US. And in fact, the FBI undercover agent was trying to investigate the Secret Service undercover agent, not realizing that they were both theoretically on the same side, until the British officer who was involved pointed this out. The problem is there is a mixing of national security interests with criminal interests. Now, the reason why those intelligence agencies were there is they were looking to see if there was any connection with terrorist financing. They want to know what are the crimes that are going to reach us in 5 or 10 years' time or sooner than that. So there's a lot of mixing going on. I want to explain to you how this happened by going back to the wonderful world of Carter Planet. Now, Carter Planet, apart from being the revolutionary cybercrime site that it was, also, to my absolute astonishment, they are the only organization that I know who have organized a public conference for criminals, rather like this one, only criminals instead of you. It was called the first Worldwide Carters Conference, and they invited criminals from all over the world, 400 of them, to come to Odessa in Ukraine. And I was very proud when on the deep web I discovered the press release for the first Worldwide Carters Conference. They had breakout sessions which were entitled things like,
Why do we focus on Visa and MasterCard? Why can't we develop niche markets in American Express and Diners? Good question, I thought. Anyway, I wasn't there to hear the answer, but I was struck by the first clause of the press release. It said, once again, the critical issue of the inadmissibility of any action in relation to the billing system, banks, or any other financial institution in Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus was raised. Furthermore, the family, those are the administrators of Carta Planet, will deal ruthlessly with any Carta found engaging in such activity. So I said to myself, wait a minute. They go to all the trouble of being the only organization ever in world history to organize a conference of criminals in public. And the first thing they say is, we will not allow you to engage in criminal activity in this particular place. I thought, what is the point? So I went to see two of the administrators of Carta Planet. One of them was in a prison in Brooklyn, New York. The other was a presidential candidate in Ukraine. That's what happens if you're a hacker. You could go any way at all. And I said, what was all that about? And they said, well, it was quite simple, because 2 days before the opening of the first Worldwide Carta Conference, we got a visit from Moscow from the KGB. And they said, look, we don't care how much money you steal from America or Europe or Japan, but if you go anywhere near any financial institutions in Russia, we will send you to a virtual Siberia before you can say Microsoft. And they said, oh, right, okay, we understand that. And then they said another thing the KGB officers said, if we require your services for the purposes of national security, you will jump too. And we saw that 6 years later with the attack on Estonia in 2007, where half of the massive DDoS attack on Estonia was traced back by American and Israeli intelligence officers to the servers of something called the Russian Business Network, which at the time was the largest Russian criminal cyber group. Now, it's not only Russia that is involved in all of this, but there's a reason why Russia specializes in cybercrime. This you can see from 2016 GDP. Russia is a tenth of the size of the American economy. Look, it's even half the size of post-Brexit bedraggled Britain. And still, it survives. And the thing about Russia is that it has the nuclear arsenal, the legacy of the Cold War, yes, but it cannot keep up with the investment required in technology and weaponry that the Chinese and the Americans are able to bring to the table. And so it has no choice but to find other ways of maintaining parity on the global stage. And this is where we come to the Gerasimov doctrine. Valery Gerasimov is the head of the Russian armed forces. And he spelled out in an article a couple of years ago, he said, look, Russia cannot keep up with what's going on elsewhere. And so we have no choice but to use other weaponry. And basically, he said, we have got to use information security. Now, the reason why the Russians were able to do this, and believe me, it's not just the Russians now who get involved in this. Everyone is involved in this game. The reason why the Russians get involved in this is because of the fact that they don't have the money, but we have no international regulation of the internet at all. And this is a problem as long as Russia, China, and the US are not talking to each other about how you have sensible governance of the internet. Everyone is involved in the game of developing offensive cyber capability. And that includes India, it includes Israel, it includes Britain, it includes over 120 countries now. This is very frightening. We need proper governance internationally of the internet. And we can already see the consequences if we fail to do that. And it's quite terrifying. Truly, we live in a world of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome
and put your hands together to welcome Mr. KP Unnikrishnan on the dais to conduct an interactive session with Mr. Misha Glenny. I was expecting a round of applause, everyone.
Is it working?
Thank you very much. It was very entertaining and educative.
Thanks.
Thank you. In fact, for your next book, and since you're in India, I might have a little bit of an idea what could be the name of McMafia.
Tell me.
McMafia on the Onion Trail.
I must say, I've been reading, when I come to a country, I always read the local press obsessively. And actually, the story about the onions, I think could be very interesting, because I've tried to understand why these price rises are happening, and it's to do with the harvest and everything, and whether this level of price rise has ever happened before. And according to my research so far, it hasn't happened before. And the question then is, what is causing this? So in the humble onion, if you unpeel it, as it were, if you'll excuse the pun, we'd be able to, I think you would find some interesting things behind it. So yes, maybe I will write a book about onions next.
And we should work out what should be the next cyber strategy to stop onto that.
That's right.
So, you know, one of the things that I wanted to kind of, talk to you, and I'm sure most of the audience may not know this, for somebody who's very excited about reading about crime and watching movies on crime, it's a very different angle when you've got to be interacting with some of these folks when you create your own book. How did you go about doing that? Was it scary? Question number one. And question number two, how much of your journalistic skills did you use to really get answers out of criminals?
Well, to both questions, I mean, I did two books specifically talking to groups of criminals, then another one which is talking basically to one criminal. Those people involved in traditional organized crime are much scarier in person.
Okay.
So the difference between traditional mafia organizations and cyber criminal organizations, and it is a very wide difference, is that if you want to be a player in traditional mafia groups, you have to have the ability to threaten or deploy serious violence. And what is revolutionary about cybercrime is you don't need to deploy violence. So you can be in Astana, you can in Kazakhstan attack somebody in Calcutta, cash out in Dubai, and you don't need a virtual baseball bat to do it. So what that meant is that cybercrime attracted a very different type of personnel. They tended to be better educated. They came from all social classes, all backgrounds, all levels of education, but they tended not to be violent. So when I was doing the book on cybercrime, the great problem I had was tracking them down, although some of them, like the Carter Planet administrator, were in prison, so it was quite easy to track them down. But I didn't feel threatened very much. When I was doing McMafia and I was talking to really serious organized criminal players, then I had to be much more careful about how I approached them, what I talked to them about, and what I found, it's my own personal style, is the most effective way of talking to people who are potentially dangerous is that, first of all, you spend quite a long time in advance arranging the meeting, and usually through interlocutors who the criminal trusts. So you have to find those people who go from the licit to the illicit, and there are lots of them, lawyers, journalists, policemen, and so on. You have to find them. And then, when you talk to them, what I do is I don't start saying, so what's it like having killed five people last week? I say, where were you born? What did your parents do? And I get them to talk about themselves, because although criminals don't like talking about their criminal activity, they're human beings, And what human beings love to do more than anything else is talk about themselves. So once you get them going talking about themselves, it sort of transitions into talking about their activities. But I met members of the FARC in Colombia, who are basically organized crime in fatigues. I met an assassin in Mumbai, who was very cold when it came to describing exactly how he shot people. He took me to the places and showed me what the thing was. I met the head of a Yakuza organization in Japan. Really weird, weird people. I went into a drug dealing center in a township in South Africa at 11 o'clock at night. And all of these things that you're not meant to do, but if you organize them properly, once they start telling you about the business, you learn about the way the world works in a way that no academic, no police officer, no lawyer can really tell you, can give that explanation. So it was fun.
So definitely not for the faint-hearted.
Mm-mm. No. I mean, having said that, I covered the wars in Yugoslavia, and I was under artillery and sniper attack for a long periods of time, and actually I was in greater clear and present danger covering Yugoslavia than seeing the criminals. But when you go and see criminals, you're much more isolated. You're not with a bunch of other journalists. There's no camaraderie. You're going into dark places on your own. And you know, it has been it's not easy.
Fair. So you in your book and in the articles you've written about the whole shadow economy around crime, and you know, as the industry will probably know, earlier on the drug mafia was one of the largest pipeline in terms of business that they would generate, and then you had the whole cyber mafia that came in. And you and I were talking about it today morning, and you kind of gave me some insight about how actually these are coming together. So you want to throw some light to the audience on what you have been seeing?
Yeah, this is very important. If you remember what I said about the violence, the non-violence, for 10 years or so, cyber mafias and organized crime were living in parallel. They didn't pay much attention to each other. And then what you saw happening is you saw a generation of people involved in traditional organized crime who were digital natives. Yep. And so they understood the value of cyber as a way of making your business more effective and more efficient, and they started adopting those techniques. We have seen this in the illegal narcotics market in the United Kingdom now. 25% of all illegal drugs consumed in the UK are sold over the internet through the darknet market. We have seen it when it comes to people trafficking in a big way, the use of WhatsApp and GPS functions and so on and so forth. And conversely, cyber criminals have learned from traditional organized crime about how you organize properly. So 15 years ago, the people from Carta Planet were all script kiddies or lone wolves. They were operating on their own. Now, cyber criminal organizations are built up cell-like structures. They've learned from organized crime. And so you have a person directing the operation. You'll have the malware writer, the malware deployer, the person who controls the mules, and they will be targeting organizations. And that's the difference. If you're the victim of a drive-by attack or a chance attack of malware, that means quite simply that your cybersecurity regime is weak. Your big problem these days is you are going to be targeted. And people will spend months researching your company, your habits. They'll be looking at your Facebook page. They'll know when you leave your home, when you get to the office. They'll know the things that you like, that you don't like. And they will be targeting members of that corporation relentlessly because they will be seeking a way in to the network.
So it's not a question of will you be breached or attacked, it'll be a question of when it's going to happen.
Essentially it is, and that's a very important point, Uni, because of what can you do to protect yourself if it is a question of when are you going to be breached. And I have, in my own personal life, I have a very simple rule, and that is the crown jewels, and in my case the crown jewels tend to be those interviews I've done with people involved in organized crime or intelligence agents and things like that. I record them on a digital voice recorder. That then goes onto a MacBook, which has never been connected to the internet. And then both devices, the digital voice recorder and the MacBook, go into a safe, and the safe is locked physically. So those are my crown jewels. What I then have to accept is everything else on my computer, my browsing habits, whatever it is, my emails, I assume they can be and are being read. On a simple personal level, that's a manageable thing that you can do. With a company, with digital transformation coming in, it's much more complex. And that's why, you know, development operations, DevOps, and so on, is really becoming a major part of how you're going to structure the security of a company.
And I guess sometimes the scary part of how people look at it is, are you going to kind of getting into an air gap where you keep stuff on the network and then you yank everything out and keep it separate?
And also there's also the legacy thing, a lot of breaches. Right. So that 15% of breaches which have not come from a phishing attack, there are basically 2 to 3 main vectors. That's insider information, mm-hmm. that happens a lot, the disgruntled employee.
Right.
Then you have third party, the supply chain being compromised. And the third one, I've forgotten what the third one is, but it's actually very important, the first one I thought about, but I'll think about it in a minute.
Maybe I could add the fourth one of your neighbor's kid sitting in a garage trying to play around.
The legacy computers.
Yeah.
There was a big hack about 4 years ago of TalkTalk, which was one of the UK's most important information communications company, and they had taken over another company, Tiscali, and they had just added on Tiscali's servers to their own. There was nothing there in terms of protection, and TalkTalk has been almost destroyed as a consequence of this because they weren't auditing their legacy servers and computers properly.
So in your presentation, Misha, you spoke about the whole human factor. So what would be your advice to the audience over here? Awareness plays a critical component, but I mean, we spoke about it this morning. Is it the government's responsibility? Is it your organization? Is it the individual? Where do you see people over here thinking about cyber?
Well, governments are clearly very concerned about this, but let's be honest, particularly after 10 years of austerity in most countries in the world, governments do not have the resources to protect the private sector. Furthermore, the critical national infrastructure, I'm not sure how it functions here in India, but in the United Kingdom, 90% of the critical national infrastructure is in private hands. Mm. And so this can only be a partnership. We have a relatively good model in the UK, which is the National Cybersecurity Centre, which is the public face of GCHQ, our digital spy agency, and it interacts very well with industry in terms of assisting them. But you are only ever going to get assistance from the government. Companies, corporations, institutions, individuals, NGOs, ultimately, you have to be responsible for your own cybersecurity because the buck stops here, basically. And in order to do that, the most important thing, we talked about the importance of education, the societal education in schools, in the media, and things like that. It's difficult because cybersecurity and computers are intrinsically boring as subjects to most people. So you've got to find entertaining ways of getting the message across. That's the first thing. And then there is education within companies. And this is really, this remains the biggest vulnerability of all, is that companies do not look at their digital hygiene regime holistically. They look at it purely as you get information security just to put on some nuts and bolts around the system, and that will do you. It's not enough.
So clearly, it's a shared responsibility for everybody, and you're as strong as your weakest link, and if that's not addressed, that's the end of the story.
That's it.
We're coming to the top of the hour, Misha, so just to kind of maybe close on, BBC and AMC with McMafia, doing Hollywood with Nemesis. Tell the audience, what about Bollywood?
Well, that'll be for the Onion Mafia. we do, of course, in McMafia, I wrote about Mumbai and crime in organized crime in Mumbai in the case of Dawood Ibrahim, which was absolutely fascinating. But I've got to say this about, I mean, I'm very fortunate. It is extremely unlikely that a non-fiction book gets transformed into a fictional drama series like the non-fiction McMafia was turned into the TV drama McMafia. But here's the truth of it. McMafia came out as a book. It sold somewhere between 400,000 and 500,000 copies around the world, which is very respectable for a non-fiction book. The police liked it. The criminals liked it. And, you know, the readers liked it. But the impact we have had since McMafia came out as a television show, discussing the same issues of crime, corruption, money laundering, and so on, the impact has been enormous. And so for me, as somebody who wants to get complicated but very important ideas about the modern world out there, it is something that you have to explore. You have to explore television drama, because that is where people get their information from.
Absolutely. It's not about the boring nuts and